So hi, today I'd like to talk to you about some concepts related to DC direct current circuits. There are also AC circuits, which are alternating current. The difference is, with direct current, the charge moves in one direction through a circuit. With AC current, the charge is pushed and then pulled and pushed and pulled. So today we're talking about DC circuits, and in particular, we'll talk about simple series and parallel resistor circuits and some theorems that help us simplify these circuits so that we're only looking at a voltage and a resistance. So what exactly all am I talking about? So let's get started. This is a classic series DC circuit. The direct current source is the battery. Battery has a polarity. Charge comes out of the high side, runs around the circuit if you complete the circuit, and then goes to the low side. Typically, the low side is 0 volts. And the high side, let's pick a battery voltage, 10 volts. Now, in these DC circuits, we have a law that holds as far as how much current should run through a circuit given a certain resistance and a certain voltage. And that law is Ohm's law. And Ohm said that the push that you see in a circuit is equivalent to the charge that flows and the resistance that's pushing back. So push equals flow times pushback. So let's pick some numbers. Let's say we have a resistor value of let's pick 100 ohms, make it simple. So ohms is the symbol for, this is Greek omega, for resistance. And the symbol we use for current is amperes and A, and the symbol we use for voltage is volts. So we've got 100 ohms, we've got 10 volt battery, and in this case here, we'll see current flow in this direction. The symbol to show current is I. It's from the French intensité du charge, but regardless, it's a letter I. Now, so we have a voltage, we have 10 volts, and we have a resistance. So if we rearrange Ohm's law, okay, if we take 10 volts and divide it by 100 ohms, we're going to get 0.10 amps. Or in engineering dimensions, we like to use powers of 3. So this would be milliamps equal to 100 times 10 to the minus 3 amps. Okay, that's a very simple circuit. Now, I'm going to add a small complication to the circuit, and I'm going to add another resistor. Resistors, when you add them in series, they add together. So let me just clean the board just a touch, and just to make this look a little cleaner to our viewers. So let me take the same circuit and add another resistance to it. Now, in this one here, let's use the 10 volts again. This is the plus side, this is the high side. And let's use, we can use the same thing. We can do 100 ohms, let's leave it there. And here we'll put 400 ohms. And let's just do some understanding of what's going on in a circuit. First of all, this is the high side. So the charge is going to come out of the high side of the battery, and it's going to come through those two resistors and come back to the low side of the battery. In doing so, we're going to develop a potential across these two resistors. There's going to be a current flowing and a resistance pushing back, which means there's a voltage across here. Same thing, current is flowing, resistance is there, I times R, a voltage will be across that resistor. We call that voltage drop. The voltage at this point will be 10 volts. The voltage at this point will be less than 10 volts, and the voltage at this point will be 0 volts. Now, one other symbol that you often see in these circuits is this symbol here. This symbol is for ground. This essentially sets a reference. A battery by itself floating in space is some high side and low side, but with respect to what? With respect to what? So what we do is we anchor one side of it to a chassis and then say Mother Earth, ground. And so this is a ground symbol. That just says, when you see that, it's 0 volts. It's 0 volts. Now, that means we have 10 volts up here. We have some less voltage because of the drop here. And then we have 0 volts at this point. So what is that? We could say, well, let's go back to Ohm. If he said V equals I times R, and in this case now we have R is equal to, our total R is equal to, in this case, R1 and R2. And that sum is 500 ohms. Oops, 500, give me a sec. That's the total resistance. Then this current that is flowing is equal to 10 volts divided by 500 ohms. And that equals 0.02 amps, which is equal to 20 milliamps. So I want you to check my math. So that's 1 divided by 50, that's 0.1 divided by 5, that's 0.1 divided by 5.02, 20 milliamps. Okay, 20 milliamps. We have 20 milliamps running through this circuit. That's the I flowing through this circuit. Now, if that is the case, there's going to be a voltage drop across here and a voltage drop across here so that we result with 0 volts. So the voltage drop across the 400 ohms and the voltage drop across the 100 ohms will add up to 10 volts. Is that the case? If we look at R times I equals V, Ohm's law one more time, then we would have for R1, 100 ohms times 0.02 is equal to 2 volts. And for R2, we would have 400 ohms times 0.02, and that will equal 8 volts. So across here, this point here, we'll have 8 volts. 0 volts at this point, and as you know, 10 volts at that point. A 2-volt drop across the 100 ohms, an 8-volt drop across the 400 ohms. I'm going to clean the circuit up a bit, come back to this particular design here, and we're going to do that calculation in another fashion. So coming back to the same circuit, I'd like to calculate the voltage across the 400 ohms in a slightly different manner as before. Ohm's law still applies. Okay, Ohm's law still applies. But if we look at this circuit, we see that there is one current, which we calculated was 20 milliamps based on the total resistance of 500 ohms and 10 volts pushing it. If we look at that, the current through this resistor, and again, let's do R1 and R2. The current through R1 is going to be basically, is going to be V over R, okay? So we look at the current through R1, and then we look at the current through R2. Again, it's V over R. There's some voltage here. The voltage here and the voltage across R1 will add up to the source voltage. So if we look at this, we say, okay, this is some percentage of that, but they have to add up the total. In other words, if I have 400 ohms over a total of 500 ohms, and I multiply that by the source, I will get the voltage across R2. Really? How do you do that? In other words, what I said was if I take R2 and divide it by R1 plus R2 and multiply it by the source voltage, I will get the voltage across R2. Okay, so if we try to understand that, I mean, we can develop this as an equation. We can say the ratio of the voltages, so the voltage across R2 over the total voltage is equal to, in this case here, it's going to be the current through R2, and the total was the current through R1 plus R2, and we see these cancel, And if we take our voltage source to the other side, for example, if I multiply by V source here and V source here, because in an equation, whatever you do to the left side, you have to do to the right side. So then we see these two cancel. We're left with V across R2 is equal to R2 over R1 plus R2 times the source. Same thing here. So this formula holds. This is known as a voltage divider rule. And it's a quick and dirty way to come up with, instead of calculating total resistance, and therefore voltage divided by total resistance to get the current, then multiplying the current through the resistor, still holds. Fundamental still holds. There's another way of doing it, saying this is a part of the total pi, and if I take this as a percentage of the total pi, what is left? So if we do the numbers again, remember we had 8 volts from the previous discussion, we would have, in this case here, 4 fifths times 10 is equal to 4 times 2 is equal to 8 volts. Same number.